Good afternoon and welcome everyone to the third webinar of the Best in Procurement series. We had two sessions over the past couple of days. They were particularly successful with Telstra and Qantas. They went through respectively their Supplier Relationship Management Award and the Best Project Improvement. Today we are lucky enough to have two people from the team at the University of Sydney who led the project that led to the successful victory of the awards for Best Public Procurement Project. Just a reminder that this year's awards will be held on the 18th of July in Sydney. We will be confirming the venue very shortly, and the deadline for submission is the 14th of April. From the University of Sydney, we have today Tabassum Humza, Category Manager, and Graham Hume, Sourcing Manager. They're both from the Research and Teaching Equipment and Consumables team in the Procurement Services, and they will be talking through the project from conception all the way to outlining some of the key outcomes. It's quite a unique entry. Just to give you a quick overview of the initiative, it was a pretty complex sourcing project for a very special piece of equipment, which is an MRI machine. So what they will go through particularly is the benefit they managed to embed into this process for the customer, but also the skills in negotiating particular terms and conditions with their suppliers. So just letting you know that the webinar will be recorded, so you will be able to access it after the fact and download a copy should you wish. You can submit the questions all the way through the presentation, and the speakers will be able to view it, and we will try to answer as many as possible. Again, just a reminder that we'll have two more webinars, one coming up later this afternoon and one coming up tomorrow with Caltex and the City of Gold Coast. So we don't take in any more time from the guys at Uni Sydney. I'll hand over to Graham, who'll start the presentation and guide us through the University of Sydney project. Graham, and over to you.
Thank you, Giovanni. Good evening, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Graham Young, and I'm a sourcing manager at the University of Sydney and the procurement lead for the project we are presenting today. With me today is Tabassum Humza.
Hi, Graham. My name is Tabassum. I'm the Category Manager for Research and Teaching Equipment at Sydney. We're here to provide some insights into our submission of the High Field Preclinical MRI project, which won last year's Best Public Procurement Project at the 2016 CIPS Australasian Awards. Just in case you're wondering, the MRI, or Magnetic Resonance Imaging Instrument, uses magnetic fields and radio waves to generate images of the insides of bodies. In this case, it's a preclinical instrument imaging animals such as mice, rabbits, rats. The instrument was procured for the Sydney Imaging Core Facility, which is located at the Charles Perkins Centre on our Camperdown campus. Some more information about this facility will be shared in the next slide.
The Charles Perkins Centre was established in 2014. It is a world-class research facility dedicated to easing the burden of obesity, diabetes, and cardiovascular disease and the related conditions, helping to reduce associated deaths, improve quality of life, and transform the health of the world. These diseases are global issues. World Health Organization stats show that an estimated 23.7 million people die each year from these diseases. Just to put that in context, that's like the equivalent of the entire population of Australia dying each year. And the economic cost of this is enormous. Other WHO stats from 2012-2015 show that it costs the world economies around $3.4 trillion a year. Now, the consequences of these and causes of these diseases are much more complicated than biology alone. So the Charles Perkins Centre is a multidisciplinary cross-collaborative research center that explores the interconnectedness of our bodies, the environment, food, and health. The researchers at the Charles Perkins Center and across the university are supported by 7 core research facilities, 6 of which are located at the center itself, and of which Sydney Imaging is one. These core research facilities provide access to high-end research infrastructure and bring together a critical mass of researchers from diverse disciplines, which helps promote collaborative research across the different disciplines. A little bit more now about the Sydney Imaging, our core facility. Now, this is a brand new core facility for the university, and it will be officially opened in 2017. The high-field preclinical MRI that we procured will be the flagship instrument for this facility. It was identified along with other instruments as key pieces of research infrastructure required for Sydney Imaging. This followed a comprehensive discovery and engagement process with stakeholders across the university landscape that covered the different faculties, schools, disciplines, and affiliated medical research institutes to identify the research infrastructure required for Sydney Imaging. This engagement and consultation with stakeholders led to the development of the Sydney Imaging Roadmap, a blueprint for current and future investment in imaging capability. It will provide a platform for the university to perform the cutting edge at the cutting edge of biomedical imaging research and ensure that resources are invested in a coordinated, evidence-based and strategic manner.
I'll talk to our implementation some more. In terms of the project team and actually defining the specifications, a cross-functional project team representing many diverse stakeholders who had been previously consulted was formed to guide the procurement and also to develop the very technical complex specifications based on feedback received during our consultation. In terms of market assessment, at the time, market analysis indicated there were limited suppliers capable of supplying the research-focused MRI. Some well-established, having a long history in the market, there were others being relatively recent entrants with a relatively smaller number of instruments within the worldwide research community. Our strategy considered capability as well as reliability in determining the best way to engage. In terms of developing specifications, one of the key requirements for the university was the development of a strategic partnership, and the market engagement documentation was designed to solicit the best response from the market and included details on the university's research direction and interest, prompting suppliers to think about matters such as their own research priorities and areas of commercial interest, the value add the supplier would bring to the table, what the supplier perceives as the benefits of working with the university, and their vision and ideas around a strategic partnership. These allowed the university to assess alignment between potential suppliers and the university on research goals and priorities.
Thanks, Tabs. I'll just give you a quick overview now of the management of the process. In terms of governance, a core facilities procurement steering group had been previously formed to provide guidance and to ensure that all core facility market engagements was in alignment to the overall university research strategy and our procurement policy. The membership of this group was cross-functional and cross-disciplinary, representing many stakeholder groups, including our IT department, our campus infrastructure, our research office, finance, the Sydney Medical School, the Faculty of Health Sciences, the Charles Perkins Centre, and of course, procurement services. The university uses e-tendering tool for the procurement and to communicate with suppliers during the out-to-market phase. Communications is always important during the procurement process, and a number of meetings was held with suppliers to further discuss the development of a long-term relationship with the university. The parties work closely together and communicated openly on the possibilities and the framework to develop the relationship platform that would lead ultimately to improve research outcomes and eventually the societal benefits. During the market engagement phase to manage our risks, the university undertook due diligence on the suppliers. It was a very detailed and wide-ranging process that included the assessment of imaging data from similar instruments located at other research facilities, a site visit to an international facility with similar instruments, obtaining independent technical expert assessment of the imaging data that we obtained from that site visit, and conducting a detailed assessment of the financial health of the supplier. In terms of the results achieved, the project team was able to achieve a very positive result from this procurement, delivering an outstanding commercial outcome for the university in both hard and soft benefits. While these benefits need to be treated as commercial in confidence, evidence was provided to the evaluation team for the CIPS submission last year to make a strong case for our project. It was a very good team effort with all members working really well together and contributing their expertise to help achieve this result. I'll go through some of the research benefits we achieved as well out of this machine and out of this negotiation. The equipment will enable critical translational research, making it feasible to screen the entire spectrum of the disease process from disease onset to progression and therapy monitoring. The actual in-house availability of this capability saves a conservatively estimated 3,000 hours per annum in research time. That's from cutting back from travel time to external facilities that our researchers had to make, thereby leading to increased research productivity. The world-class facility will attract leading academics and the best and brightest students, lifting the results, ranking, reputation, and profile of the university. This equipment will also help develop in-house MRI expertise. And finally, the facility will promote collaborative opportunities across disciplines as users will cross paths through planned workshops and seminars. In regards to our strategic partnership with the preferred vendor, we have advanced discussions with the supplier to formalise this partnership. And finally, Tabs will now give you some tips for a successful submission.
Thanks, Graham. So sharing with you some of what worked well for the University of Sydney, firstly, choosing a strong contender for a specific CIPS category. You know, think about the work in your landscape, and you'll often find there's a clear winner and a clear contender for recognition. Clear a hook that will engage the audience, make a case that will engage the reader. The university knew this project had significant research benefits. Additionally, the societal benefits were immense and included in the submission, forming a clear hook that I've talked about. Easy to read format backed up with evidence. So key is providing compelling evidence to support your submission. I think that's all from us, and we're happy to take any questions you might have.
Okay, thank you guys for the presentation. It's been very, very insightful. I've got a question while we're waiting for the audience to submit their request. I guess given the complexity of the project, from a business perspective, coordinating a large number of stakeholders was quite a challenge. Do you have any insight on how you managed to do that?
Yeah, sure. We had a very formal approach. We contacted each of the heads of schools that would be in line to be using this type of equipment, as well as the CEOs of the major of the medical research institutes, and asked them to provide feedback on their requirements over the next 5 years. This was in the developing of the roadmap. And then we followed this up with meetings with each of them. We asked them to nominate a champion as well so that we can have follow-up meetings. And that champion will represent the different research groups within each of those faculties or institutes. And then they submitted a formal submission to us. And what we did then was prioritise what the requirements were right across the university.
We have a question here from one of the attendees. Who led the negotiation? Specifically, how did you negotiate or discuss the cost, reduction of support services, and software upgrades? Did you promise the supplier more business in the near future? Quite a complex question there. In terms of, I think, taking it one step at a time, who led the negotiations? So whilst the commercial negotiations at the university are led by procurement, we are very closely aligned with our stakeholders that form part of the evaluation team. So in that sense, I'd probably say it was, whilst we take the commercial lead, it is a project team that actually steps into these negotiations. In terms of negotiating benefits with the supplier and the promise of business in the future, look, that's obviously something we would not position in a negotiation. What we do, however, position very strongly is the opportunity for the supplier to collaborate with the university in the research that we do. So that was part of something that we very strongly positioned. We have a very good idea of the landscape and the kind of research that is being undertaken. So there are opportunities there for us to, present opportunities for collaboration to the supplier, which is what we did do.
Okay. Any other questions?
I might have another one from a customer perspective. You know, it was mentioned in the submission that the there's a testing side for the supplier to develop that technology, which ultimately made through procurement and thanks to procurement the organization more attractive to customer. Can you just elaborate a little bit more on that, on what that meant for the organization and also for the procurement team, obviously?
Yeah, sure. I mean, they were part of the ongoing discussions we're having them with them now in terms of developing a strategic partnership. But obviously, being a manufacturer of medical equipment, we offered them the opportunity to maybe showcase some of the other equipment down the track if there was an opportunity to do so. I mean, There's a big wide base of researchers here at the university across many different fields of research. So it offers manufacturers such as the preferred supplier to really have an opportunity to hold seminars and forums about the equipment that's coming up in their pipeline, and maybe even the possibility of leaving the machine in one of our facilities for a little while for researchers just to play around with. So definitely in the discussion we're having with them right now.
That's great. So we had another question that came through, and it's asking, are you guys category manager and sourcing manager in IT? And I guess that answers that. Yeah. I don't think it's IT, but you guys can clarify that. And he says, if not, why they're not part of the process? So they're asking why IT is not being involved, especially when we're dealing with software, which always part of the ongoing IT OPEX as well. So do you guys
want to? No, absolutely.
Can I take that? Yeah, okay. I'll take that one if that's all right. So we are part of the research and teaching equipment and lab supplies category. So not part of the IT category. However, there was as a part of the project team, we had very strong ICT presence as well. So in terms of when Graham talked to, you know, who actually formed part of those part of the team, apart from many other professional services units, ICT was a strong presence sort of with most of our projects in the research space. We are finding we're working very closely with facilities and IT, because there are, it's not just the procurement, but once it's on board, how does it get housed into a facility? How does it interact with our networks? So that's, I guess, there is that consideration in the procurement process and the stakeholders that we invite to participate.
So we've seen the imaging itself. There's been a project manager from our ICT team involved because this wasn't the only piece of equipment we bought last year. I mean, we bought a whole range of different items of equipment, and they're there to support, provide support for the IT side of the of this equipment in terms of the data storage and the interface with our networks and so forth. So we do work very closely with ICT, as well as with our campus infrastructure in terms of any building works that's required for any equipment that's coming in.
Awesome. One last question from my end, guys. The project was awarded as the best public procurement project, so I guess the social component of its importance, as you guys outlined, was quite high. Was there any particular driver within the procurement process that impacted, you know, the social aspect of the work that you guys were carrying on?
Giovanni, I think the best way to answer that question is to look at the university. And I guess what we are in the business of, you know, doing. So education and research is a very strong focus at Sydney. And the the translational aspects of the research that we are doing are always, I guess, top of mind. So whilst we are, you know, busily procuring equipment for many core research facilities, I guess the end game is the research that allows us to translate this into application for mankind. So that's a key underlying theme in what we are trying to do in our research at Sydney. Does that answer your question?
Absolutely. Yeah. So if no one has any other questions, and it does look like it's the case, actually, no, we do have one question. It just came through as we were closing. So are you guys happy to answer the one last question? Do we have time for that?
Sure, happy to take it, Giovanni.
Perfect. So the question asks, when assessing the supplier and their equipment, did you reach out to any of their existing customer for feedback? That's a bit of an interesting one.
When during the assessment process, no, we did independent assessments each stakeholder, but we did do reference checks as well. So we asked them, each supplier to provide references. So we did our background checks on that as well. Okay. Does that answer?
You could perhaps talk to the site visit as well.
Oh yeah. So obviously, we also knew of existing equipment that was held at one of the US sites, similar to the instrument we're looking at that was in line for procurement for us. And we organized two of our researchers to go over there to look at its capability and capacity and whether or not it met our needs. So we did a very comprehensive job in that case in terms of reference checking and as well as our due diligence on the actual technical aspects of the equipment.
Right. Wonderful. Thank you very much, guys, for your time and effort. It's quite important that we do share success story and we do provide overview on what procurement excellence looks like. So once again, thank you for participating and providing us with very valuable insight on your project. I'd like to thank again Graham and Tabassum for their contribution, and thank everyone who's been listening to this webinar. Remembering again that this will be recorded and you can review it after the factum. I encourage you to prepare your application for the CIPS Awards if you haven't started yet. And we look forward to having you for the upcoming webinars, one of which will be in about 35 minutes. So thank you again, Graham and Tabassum, and we look forward to connecting with you in the future again.
Thanks, Giovanni.
Thank you.